Thank you very much, Richard. I think everyone in this room, looking at your body language and my body language when we are shaking hands, and they actually try to read between line when you are introducing me, so I think it's good. But thank you so much for a very, very generous introduction. Minister Luhut, the old soldier which never died, and very charming general, our coordinating minister for maritime, economy and maritime, Agus, our central bank governor, another very charming central bank governor, David Merrill, everybody's a little bit, maybe some Indonesian knows when Pak Luhut repeatedly mentioned Bu Ani, but you should ask question, who's Bu Ani? Bu Ani is Sri Mulyani actually, so they call me Bu Ani, just want to translate that. But David, as well as all colleagues and friends here, thank you very much for inviting me here. This is actually my second chance to speak in front of you at the USINDO dinner after my return to Indonesia as a finance minister. It is, of course, very pleased to be back in Washington, although I expect much cooler and to see a lot of autumn leaves, but then I disappointed because it's very warm, and also the leaf is still green, so I'm disappointed of that. Of course, this is not a climate change, because there is no climate change. So it's just warmer autumns here. So what is actually a lot of thing I miss in Washington? Just a year ago, and Tony and I mostly miss about DC as a private, quiet life in here. It's just a regular, normal human being. I think rarely people asking me for selfie in Washington DC, except this morning maybe. And we also have a sufficient time to do little things we enjoy. I like to have this kind of a memory of having time strolling along the Potomac River, enjoying the autumn leaf, especially during these months. We also have a fond memory of, I think, next month, of cooking 15 pounds of turkey with the Indonesia recipe and inviting Indonesian friends to have the Thanksgiving dinner. We are actually awkward talking about Thanksgiving dinner for Indonesia. We have more Idul Fitri. But I have a very good innovation in cooking turkey with like ayam kalasan type of, so. I also miss watching my backyard with my friends, that is three squirrel with almost every morning coming, and we name them. One is a little bit black, other a little bit white, so we miss them very much. So back in Jakarta is a totally different life with a different environment. Of course, what I like most in Jakarta is close to a lot of my friends and good food, much, much better than Washington DC, especially the World Bank food, of course, for 6 years. So, and of course, for me, especially being in Jakarta, gave me another opportunity to work under a leadership of President Jokowi and Vice President Gala, a very committed leaders, which is really have a lot of impatience to deliver a good thing for their people. So it's really a privilege and honor for me to be back there. First, for all my American friends, let me express my heartfelt sympathy with the victim of first tragic mass shooting in Las Vegas. We also know that violence and that kind of tragedy now could happen everywhere in the world. My heart also goes out to the victim of the recent natural disaster in Texas, Florida, and Puerto Rico. That remind me when watching all those, remind me when we have to rebuild the Aceh after tsunami. So may their life and livelihood return in normalcy as soon as possible. So let me update you about the Indonesian economy. Part of it is already being touched by Pak Luhut. As a finance minister, maybe I will choose the angle more on macroeconomic and the budget. As you know that Indonesia is an open economy, so we are not immune to what is happening in the global economy and geopolitical development. So the global economy, geopolitical volatility, and of course, to some extent, recovery of the commodity price lately is affecting Indonesia. The last one is more positively, but the other two, that is the geopolitical and the global economy, is still actually creating a headwind for the economy, for all economy, but also including Indonesia. So this year, we are expecting a growth, which is already mentioned by Minister Luhut, 5.2 within our budget, although some is actually predicting 5.1. So we will look at the next two quarters to finish this year. It is supported strongly by continued pickup on the investment side, continued stable consumption, although some of the very quite high attention in Indonesia now scrutinizing whether Indonesia has a weakening purchasing power and slightly weak of the consumption growth. When I said consumption growth a little bit weak in this case, we are talking about 4.94%, which is almost 5%. So for Indonesia now, they are becoming very sensitive with two digit behind a two digit decimal point in this case. Amazing for Indonesia that they are now talking about between 4.93 and 5.00 is actually a big deal. But that's good about the democracy in Indonesia. Investment is getting stronger, especially with the FDI and domestic investment. So we are very much watching how we are going to make this confidence on the investment to continue and build the momentum. President continuously used build the momentum and create more confidence for all of us to work. Until today, more than 700 kilometers of road has been built and rehabilitated, and a new power plant, 35,000 megawatt, which is ongoing to be built, 210,000 housing unit for the poor families were constructed, and four new airport has been built, and another two which is ongoing. These are all the infrastructure which President Jokowi has already mentioned in many event occasion that this is in a higher priority for the government. Not at all costs, but because we know that building infrastructure is not a luxury for Indonesia. As a growing middle-income country, the need for the infrastructure is actually very, very obvious. And Indonesia has an infrastructure gap, even if you compare with the same income level of many middle-income countries in the world. So we need to make sure that this ambition is going to be governed as well as managed properly, both from the technical as well as from the financial side. We invited more and more private sector participation. Minister of Finance has already invented so many policy measures since 10 years ago of this public-private partnership. That's including guarantee, viability, payment, and also certainty of payment for many of the infrastructure development in Indonesia. We are also building and improving two very important areas that is on the health and education, that is school and hospital. A series of a program which is focusing on how we are going to create more equal opportunity, because the issue of inequality is becoming increasing attention from many of shareholders and stakeholders of Indonesia. So according to the World Bank, you cannot address the issue of inequality without addressing the issue of equal opportunity. So the upstream or the source of unequal opportunity is actually related to the poverty, which is health and education. So President Jokowi pay a very serious attention on really providing opportunity for the poor family and children to be able to go to school and to have the health services. Indonesia is now closing to the universal health coverage. Of course, this is one of the area that we in the Ministry of Finance have to calculate very carefully, so that in the future we are going to have a sustainable health system in Indonesia that will improve the quality of human capital, but at the same time it's going to be sustainable fiscally. At the macro level, I think our governor is going to cover quite a lot later on, so I'm not going to repeat, but overall the policy mix between fiscal and monetary policy has been very, very harmonious, not only because we both actually have a good relationship personally, but institutionally the working relationship between monetary authority, fiscal authority and banking supervisory authority is very, very in a very good situation. I also would like to also express this occasion to express my appreciation to Pak Melki here as the head of the committee of the Financial Supervision Commission, Financial Commission in Parliament, who also creating a good relationship with Indonesian government, with the government, in really making sure that the fiscal policy and financial sector is going to be supervised in a much sound and strong way. This is important for Indonesia. Not only that, next year, this is a voyage to Indonesia that we are going to host the IMF World Bank annual meeting. Many of actually those people who's familiar and working very closely on the financial sector also remember that 20 years ago, we have the ASEAN financial crisis, and that's why having this, hosting this IMF and World Bank in Asia again, and especially in Indonesia, one of the countries who was actually hardest hit by the financial crisis, is going to be symbolically very important for us. And making sure that not only on the macroeconomic policy, but also on the financial sector, we are going to continue maintaining a sound and strong balance sheet in order for us to be able to withstand any of the headwind or the shock coming from the global economy. So while we are having a very impressive performance in the economy, it doesn't mean that Indonesia is free from a problem or challenge. What is the challenge ahead? First, of course, as we all recognize, the uncertainty on the global economic recovery because of both geopolitical security as well as the pace of the recovery of the global economy itself. The change of the monetary policy, especially from the Federal Reserve here, is going to be very critical. But Indonesia, unlike 2013, when Janet Yellen even actually announcing her intention to end the financial easing, monetary easing, has created a tantrum all over the world, including in Indonesia. Today, when the Federal Reserve really implementing the increasing rate, Indonesia has much better resilience. But we should not exclude, or in this case, underestimate that still the possibility in terms of the risk appetite for Indonesia, especially when we are in the process or in the program of increasing growth or improving our growth performance from especially export and investment. we also have to be very careful in terms of our ability to execute the ambitious infrastructure program and project in order for us to be able to continue have a financial sound both for the state and enterprises but also on the contingent liability for our fiscal position. But we are watching very carefully and we continue actually calculating what is the exposure of risk which is coming from this infrastructure development, which is mobilizing quite a lot of resources. And this year or this month, actually we are still discussing with the parliament to finalize our budget for 2018. The 2016, as you all know, has been ended with a very sound fiscal deficit is only 2.19 and actually a 2.45, which is much, much lower than what it was expected. And this year we are aiming to have still a deficit which is below 3%. And next year we are actually designing the budget with the deficit around 2.19%. This for Indonesia audience, we are very, very, especially on the political side, the deficit is a sensitive issue, especially that their perception about debt and borrowing is actually much more sensitive. I know in the United States you're also debating about the fiscal deficit and debt to GDP, debt exposure, but Indonesia's size of the debt is much, much lower than the United States. Of course, we don't have the luxury because we are not printing US dollar, of course, so we're only printing rupiah. So that make us have a different in terms of the challenge. But we will continue have a prudent fiscal policy. The fiscal policy which supporting the economic growth, but at the same time also have the eyes on a medium and long-term sustainability. We will look more and more on the quality of spending. And this is very important because many of the, what we call it, mandatory spending mandated by either constitution, like our education spending should be 20%, or by law, like the health spending. These are all creating a much less room to maneuver for our fiscal policy. Revenue is definitely is the most important one, and that's why the tax reform has become the highest priority for Ministry of Finance. It's really great for me to be back in the Ministry of Finance because then I have all the team and working with my wonderful and strong team in the Ministry of Finance, which is, I think, it's easy then for me to then discuss with them. Implementing a reform is not easy, but there is also a good momentum on a tax reform globally. As I mentioned in many of the occasion, that today, if I compare with my position as a finance minister 10 years ago, when I talk about tax and tax reform, almost all my colleague G20 finance minister, they are also speaking the same thing. They also feel that they need to reform their tax. We're watching the tax reform here in the United States and asking whether they are going to lower the tax rate, because that will give a very serious signal to the world about what does it mean not to compete on the tax rate in this case. But what I'm saying, that many of the finance minister and the global cooperation on taxation is actually never before as stronger as today. We've already achieved what we call it the automatic exchange of information. We also discuss and deciding about the common reporting standard. So many progress which a decade ago is actually not available or never actually been expected for a minister like myself at that time to have this kind of cooperation. So with that, we are expecting to have a better tax base, a more fair, a fair tax collection, and especially for those of you who's the business who work in Indonesia, please don't feel that we are going to tax you excessively. We just want to have a fair tax just like many other countries. And for Indonesia, having a tax collection which is improving is very important because our tax to GDP ratio is still below 11%. So with that, I think we are more or less is going to have a sound and hopefully strong fiscal policy as a pillar of stability and confidence. And of course, fiscal policy is not going to address and answer all questions. And that's why we have four coordinating ministers in order for them to solve all problems. That's why Pak Luhut mentioned that we are here to solve all problems, including my problem in this case. So the reform, which is coordinated by the coordinating minister, is very important. And this is how the Indonesia has been managed the economy. There's a sound macro policy, ambitious reform, structural reform, in order for us to be able to create an environment for both the investors, domestic and international, to feel confidence to our economy. And the household consumption is also feel confidence. I'm just amazed that Luhut mentioned that the household confidence is the highest in the last 20 years. The wage rate increase, 4 million jobs has been created, and people still asking, is the consumption still strong? So that kind of discussion that we are having. I just want to reiterate again, our commitment as a government, as President Jokowi has already mentioned, that we entering to the political year 2018-19 and hosting the IMF World Bank next year, as well as the ASEAN Games, we are all instructed by the President to continue focus on working and delivering a better prosperity for the people of Indonesia. We have to coordinate better, we have to synergize across ministry between the national government, local government, and state-owned enterprise and private sector. We do hope that this is going to create more confidence for all of you to have a business. Indonesia is a country that you can really do business. Based on my experience traveling and understanding many countries in the world, I think this is a country which have the size which is big enough, and the government which is led by a leader which is very open and pragmatic. You are not going to get those kind of a combination which is actually here in Indonesia. In closing, I think I'm going to touch the US-Indonesia relationship. As you mentioned earlier, that President Jokowi and President Trump met during the G20 meeting in Germany, and they both discussing how we can enhance the cooperation between Indonesia and United States. And I think this is our job as a minister to try to translate those aspirations in order for us to be able to establish and strengthening our relationship, both at the government to government, but most importantly from private to private. So we hope that the partnership will further strengthen and implement it in the way that the spirit of win-win as mutual benefiting for both sides can be actually established. Thank you so much for again inviting me, and it's really good to be among the friends in here, and I do hope that we are going to achieve a shared prosperity between United States and Indonesia. Thank you so much.